Surviving the GFC, surviving the global financial crisis. If you have your Bibles, I'd like to invite you to open them to 2 Kings, 2 Kings chapter 18 and verse 17. We're going to look at a story this morning, which I believe sets the pattern for how we can survive not the looming but the present global financial crisis. This story sets the pattern for how we can survive it. The story is over probably close to 2,800 years old. It's an ancient story. It's an old story. But one of the things I love about the Bible is when you go there and you read the stories and you study the stories, you can always apply them to your life. And I have made it a practice in my Bible study not just to read these Old Testament stories and let them swish over my head and forget them. I stop as I'm reading them. I meditate and I ask myself the question, has this Old Testament story got anything for me, Lloyd Grolleman, living in the 21st century? Now, let me tell you a secret this morning. I have never, ever, since I've been doing this, and it's many years now, I have never read a story in Scripture that I have not, through the power of God and through the leading of the Holy Spirit, I have never read a story I have not been able to apply to my own life. And this one is one of them. It is powerful. And if everybody knew this story and practiced what happens in this story, I'm telling you, there would be no fear out there in the community, and there certainly would be no fear in the church about the global financial crisis that we now face. A global financial crisis unlike I have seen and any of you have seen in your lifetime. We have never lived through times like we are living now, and they are indeed serious and sobering times. And people, when they live through these times, they need a hope, they need a foundation, they need somewhere to go so that they can travel through the times we live in peace and assurance. And that's what today's message is about, getting through the global financial crisis with peace in your heart and assurance and hope that no matter what happens, you will see it through. 2 Kings chapter 18, verse 17. The Bible says, and I'm reading from the NIV, the king of Assyria sent his supreme commander, his chief officer, and his field commander with a large army. They went from Lachish to King Hezekiah at Jerusalem. They came up to Jerusalem and stopped at the aqueduct of the upper pool on the road to the washerman's field. Remember, it's an ancient story. It happened a long time ago. The biblical kingdom of Judah is in great danger. They are in great, great peril. Assyria, the nation who had come up against Jerusalem, against Judah, was the strongest nation in the world. And the king of Assyria, his commander, had surrounded the walls of Jerusalem. They were being besieged. Now, Sennacherib was the king. He ruled his kingdom from 705 BC to 698 BC. And he was a powerful, dangerous, very, very cruel king who belonged to a very, very cruel nation. You go back and you check your ancient history, you will find that the Assyrians were really the first nation to get involved in the mass deportation of their enemies. So they would go into a nation like Israel, like Judah, they would take out their cities, but they wouldn't just make the people slaves, they would actually uproot them from their homes. You've got to remember, if you're from Judea, this is the end of your life. This is the end of your culture. This is the end of your family. This is the end of your society. This is the end of everything you know. This King Sennacherib, he has the runs on the board. He would go in and he would uproot an entire nation and he would send them thousands of kilometers somewhere else, where he would resettle them as slaves in his kingdom. And then he would send his people into the nation that they'd overrun. and they would settle, and thus Assyria would widen its kingdom. They were the first nation to really ever get into mass deportation. But more than that, this king Sennacherib, he was into mass genocide. History tells us that many times what he would do is he would go into a nation and he would murder, kill every man, every boy, and every boy child, so that the nation would never rise again and attack him and take vengeance for what he was doing. He had a very powerful army. They were the first really in history to use a cavalry. They're the first to use successfully and effectively chariots. They were the first to build siege engines, which they would batter the walls of their enemy cities down with. Judah, Hezekiah, they were in deep, deep trouble. They were just a small nation. They served God, but they were just a small nation. And there is no way in all the world that they could stand up to this enemy. I'm going to say it again. Judah is in great danger, in great peril. Let me tell you this morning, so are we. I think you need to listen to this. In 2007, Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac, America's largest home mortgage providers, fell over. The United States of America had to bail them out. It cost them $360 billion. $1 billion, I had to go and check this because I'm not a mathematician, I'm not a banker. $1 billion is equal to one, listen to this, try and get your head around it. $1 billion is equal to $1,000 million. This is a crisis and was a crisis in the United States. Just to get these two companies out of insolvency cost the United States, listen, $360,000 million. When Andrew and I were in the United States in 2008, 2009, Andrew, the producer of this television ministry, we were over there, we did a series for Pastor Carter at his church, and then we went and we filmed 15, 20 different programs for our television show. We would go on the outskirts of Los Angeles through entire suburbs, and I'd say to Andrew, look, there's no one here. Entire suburbs of people who had reneged on their mortgage because they hadn't paid it, had left the keys on the kitchen bench and just walked out, and there are these homes, beautiful new homes, suburbs full of empty people. We would go through the streets of Los Angeles, and there was business after business after business closed down. And if you were an American living in the United States today, you would know that life is hard. Job losses have been huge, not in the thousands, not in the millions, but in the tens of millions. And people are doing it hard in the United States of America. But let me tell you that this global financial crisis that we face, which is so dangerous to us, and it is dangerous, and if you don't see it as dangerous, you're not alive, you're not awake, and you're not watching to see what happens. This global financial crisis is not just American born and made. Ireland and Greece were powerhouse banking nations in Europe. They were some of the most wealthy, effective, beautiful places, financially viable places to live in the whole of the world. They've gone broke, they're on their knees, and they're insolvent, and they're now some of the poorest countries in the Western world. You go to Greece, in the news all the time at the moment, that country is on the brink. No, it's not on the brink. Greece is insolvent. They cannot pay their bills. And it seems to me that as I watch, and I'm not a financier, but Europe seems to be just throwing good money after bad with Greece. Greece will fall over. Greece will go broke. It is impossible as a nation for them to ever repay what they owe. I was just watching on the news the other day that now if you're a homeowner in Australia, think about this. Every homeowner in Greece has been slugged a $10,000 tax. And we're told as we face these crises that we need to get out of debt, and some of you are out of debt and you own your own homes. But it seems to me as our governments try to pull ourselves out of this mess, that all they're doing is dumping us further in. And it will come to us in Australia. Italy is suffering the worst recession, depression, listen, saw this yesterday, in their history. Never has Italy faced a depression like they are now. Italy, Spain and Portugal, they cannot pay their debts. They are insolvent. These are big nations, big countries, and if they roll over, the impact on the world will be incredible. Let's go to Australia, because I notice our politicians are always telling us over here how well we're doing. Well, look at this. Our entire national debt, is not far off crashing through $1 trillion. Can you believe that? $1 trillion, do you know how much that is? It is a one with 12 zeros after it. That's $1 million. If you laid, and we don't have them, but if you laid $1 bills end to end, you could make a chain that stretches from the earth to the moon and back again 200 times before you ran out of dollar bills with our debt. $1 trillion would stretch nearly from the earth to the sun. It would take, listen to this, a military jet flying at the speed of sound, reeling out a roll of dollar bills behind it 14 years before it reeled out $1 trillion. And that is our combined debt. The federal government debt is $153 billion. The state we live in, New South Wales, is $10 billion. That's $10,000 million for our state. Federally, we owe each of us, every man, woman, and child in Australia, owes $16,750 if we were to pay these bills off. And I've got to tell you that it might not be a lot of money to you, but for most Australians, $16,750 is an enormous amount of money, and it just keeps going up. Our personal credit card debt is $50 billion, Australia. That's $50,000 million on credit card in this country. Each Australian, man, woman, and child, owes now $2,500 on credit card. Now that might not seem a lot, except remember that most of the children and youth of this country, until they're 17, 18 or plus, don't own credit cards. And they're a good proportion to the population. And as the debt noose tightens, the economy is starting to respond. Businesses are struggling to pay their debt. Jobs are starting to go. I watched as I was preparing this presentation this week, just this week, this is what I heard. ANZ, 1,000 jobs gone. Westpac, 560. Qantas, 500. Rickett, which is a fly spray company, 190. GMH, 100. Toyota, 350. Telstra, 225. Vodafone, 100. Woolworths is to close, we find out this week, 100 Dick Smith stores with 4,000 jobs gone. Youth unemployment in this country is on the brink of 20%. 14,000 jobs to be lost to the public service in the next 3 years. Yesterday, Air Australia went broke, stranding 100,000 people around the world. Caltex refineries at Kurnell in Sydney and Lytton in Brisbane are going to close down. That's 800 full-time jobs, 600 contractors, and a third of Australia's petrol supplies. My dad sent me a email this week that made me laugh. It says, wise words from a stockbroker, Edward Jones. He says, I called my stockbroker and asked him what I should be buying. He said, if the current government is in office much longer, canned goods, a generator, water, ammunition are your best investment. But I want to make a statement right here. It is not Barack Obama's fault. It is not Julia Gillard's fault. The world is headed to financial collapse. And nothing our politicians or our finances can do will save us. The system is broke and it is dying. And I'm going to make this statement. If the world doesn't end and Jesus doesn't come, then we are looking at the end of our civilization and the end of our way of life as we know it. That's a fact. If Jesus doesn't come and the world doesn't end, we are looking at the end of our civilization and our way of life as we know it. good times no longer roll. We live in a time of fear. It's a dangerous time, and we are surrounded by enemies. I feel the pressure and the tension myself, personally. Sometimes it feels like the Alamo. You ever heard of the Alamo? 1836. Ever heard of Davy Crockett? William Travis? Texas soldiers who got caught in a fort with Mexicans surrounding them. 1,500 Mexicans, about 250 Texans in the fort, 1,500 Mexicans around the fort. Travis knew they couldn't hold out. And that's how I feel sometimes. And he kept sending messages out for help. Please send reinforcements. We cannot hold. If you do not send reinforcements, we will go down. We will all die. His last message. It's a famous message. Please send help. But if we die in the war, if we die in the fight, then we will die with honor and courage. And on March 6, 1836, the Mexicans swarmed over those walls. And 250 Texans, the whole lot of them, including Davy Crockett and William B. Travis, died. We are surrounded by enemies. We are in grave danger, just like Hezekiah and the kingdom of Judah. And I feel a little bit hesitant presenting to you the facts as I have this morning, because they are so dark and they are so gloomy. And I believe as a people, Australians, church members, I genuinely believe we have a reason to be afraid. I tell you straight from the pulpit, if you can get out of debt, get out of debt. But some of us can't, no matter what we do or how we try. And so we have to go through the Hezekiah experience. And what happened to Hezekiah can happen to you as you go through your GFC, as you go through your financial crisis, if you trust in God. And this message that I'm about to show you now is about trusting in God. 2 Kings chapter 18, verse 17. The king of Assyria sent his supreme commander, his chief officer and his field commander with a large army from Lachish to King Hezekiah at Jerusalem. They came up to Jerusalem and stopped at the aqueduct of the upper pool on the road to the washerman's field. Now, it's interesting because Sennacherib was a writer. And he wrote about this siege of his army around the walls of Jerusalem and King Hezekiah. And this is what he says. I'm quoting directly the words of this king. We have found the inscriptions. This is quoting directly the words of this king in this time of crisis that he had brought about upon Hezekiah. He says, because Hezekiah, king of Judah, would not submit to my yoke, remember these are his words, I came up against him, and by force of arms and by might of power, I took 46 of his strong fenced cities and of the smaller towns which were scattered about. I took, you're getting a glimpse of this guy, I took and plundered a countless number. From these places I took and carried off 200,156 persons, old and young, male and female, together with horses and mules, asses and camels, oxen and sheep, a countless multitude. Judah is in big, big trouble and there is no escape. The Assyrian army is around Jerusalem. There are 185,000 troops around the walls. This is a huge army, perhaps the biggest army the world had ever seen to that time. They had wiped out every single city in Israel and now in Judah, every village, every town except Jerusalem, the capital. And as this army, 185,000 people, surrounded the walls of Jerusalem, the people of Jerusalem, of Judah, came up on the walls to look down at the army. And I am interested here to see what happens, because this is where the Assyrian king really ramps the pressure up. He screws the pressure up. And I want to tell you that in the next few months, maybe years, you are going to see in the world you live in the pressure screwed up tightly. Look what happens. Verse 28 of 2 Kings 19. Then the Assyrian commander stood, and he called out in Hebrew, "Hear the word of the great king, the king of Assyria, Sennacherib. This is what the king says." So now the commander of the armies of Assyria is talking to the people on the walls of Jerusalem. He says, "Do not let Hezekiah persuade you to trust in the Lord when he says, 'The Lord will surely deliver us.' This city will not be given into the hand of the king of Assyria. Do not listen to Hezekiah. This is what the king of Assyria says. Make peace with me and come out to me. Then each of you will eat fruit from your own vine and fig tree and drink wine from your own cistern until I come and take you to a land like your own, mass deportation, a land of grain and new wine, a land of bread and vineyards, a land of olive trees and honey. Choose life, not death. Do not listen to Hezekiah, for he is misleading you when he says, 'The Lord will deliver us.' Has the God of any nation ever delivered from the hand of the king of Assyria? Where are the gods of Hamath and Arpad? Where are the gods of Shebvavim, Hena, and Ivar? Have they rescued Samaria from my hand? Who of all the gods of these countries has been able to save this land from me? How then can the Lord deliver Jerusalem from my hand?" But the people remained silent and said nothing in reply because the king had commanded, "Do not answer him." This is psychological warfare. The Assyrians were the masters of it. Psychological warfare, and we've got it today. Psychological warfare. I believe the devil is ramping the pressure up. When we turn the newspaper on, all we get, when we read our newspapers or we turn on the computer and read them, all we get is doom and gloom. On the radio, all you've got is doom and gloom. Psychological warfare. On the television, the internet, social media, doom and gloom. It is so dark that I'm getting to the point where I want to turn my television off. But Hezekiah was a man of God. And he responded to the threat of Sennacherib like you and I need to respond to the threat of the global financial crisis and all the other things that are happening in our world today that threaten us. His response, Hezekiah's response, needs to be ours. 2 Kings 19, verse 1. When King Hezekiah heard this, he tore his clothes. He put on sackcloth. And he went into the temple of the Lord. He tore his clothes and put on sackcloth. Why? Well, when you tear your clothes back in ancient Israel, it's a symbolic gesture of repentance. And when you put on sackcloth, again, it is a sign of mourning for sins. Hezekiah was saying to God, "If I have sinned against you, I am sorry. If I have offended you, forgive me. Forgive us. Forgive my nation. We repent." Now, I'm telling you right now, if you are living outside the presence of God, if He is not in your life, if He is not your Savior, then now you hear me, you are living in a time when you need to do what Hezekiah did. If you do not have God as your Savior, then now is the time to accept Him. The Assyrians are around your walls. You are living in threatening times. And if you do not walk with God, now is the time to do it. Because only God will save you from what is ahead of us on this planet. 2 Kings 19 verse 1, when King Hezekiah heard this, he tore his clothes, put on sackcloth, and he went into the temple of the Lord. When Hezekiah was in trouble, I'm interested, he goes to church. And if you are in trouble, let me tell you, you also need to be going to church. Seek God. He is in the church.